Chapter 1 of The Lady with the Dog and Other Stories. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Lady with the Dog and Other Stories by Anton Chekhov. Translated by Constance Garnett. Chapter 1. The Lady with the Dog, Part 1. It was said that a new person had appeared on the seafront. A lady with a little dog. Dmitri Dmitrich Gurov, who had by then been a fortnight at Yalta, and so was fairly at home there, had begun to take an interest in new arrivals. Sitting in Verne's pavilion, he saw, walking on the seafront, a fair-haired young lady of medium height, wearing a beret, a white Pomeranian dog was running behind her. And afterwards, he met her in the public gardens and in the square several times a day. She was walking alone, always wearing the same beret, and always with the same white dog. No one knew who she was, and everyone called her simply the Lady with the Dog.
If she is here alone without husband or friends, it wouldn't be amiss to make her acquaintance, Gurov reflected.
He was under 40, but he had a daughter, already 12 years old, and two sons at school. He had been married young when he was a student in his second year, and by now his wife seemed half as old again as he. She was a tall, erect woman with dark eyebrows, staid and dignified, and as she said of herself, intellectual. She read a great deal, used phonetic spelling, called her husband not Dmitri, but Dimitri, and he secretly considered her unintelligent, narrow, inelegant, was afraid of her, and did not like to be at home. He had begun being unfaithful to her long ago, had been unfaithful to her often, and probably on that account, almost always spoke ill of women, and when they were talked about in his presence, used to call them the lower race. It seemed to him that he had been so schooled by bitter experience that he might call them what he liked. And yet he could not get on for 2 days together without the lower race. In the society of men, he was bored and not himself. With them, he was cold and uncommunicative. But when he was in the company of women, he felt free and knew what to say to them and how to behave, and he was at ease with them even when he was silent. In his appearance, in his character, in his whole nature, there was something attractive and elusive which allured women and disposed them in his favor. He knew that, and some force seemed to draw him too, to them. Experience often repeated, truly bitter experience, had taught him long ago that with decent people, especially Moscow people, always slow to move and irresolute, every intimacy, which at first so agreeably diversifies life and appears a light and charming adventure, inevitably grows into a regular problem of extreme intricacy. And in the long run, the situation becomes unbearable. But at every fresh meeting with an interesting woman, this experience seemed to slip out of his memory, and he was eager for life, and everything seemed simple and amusing. One evening, he was dining in the gardens, and the lady in the beret came up slowly to take the next table. Her expression, her gait, her dress, and the way she did her hair told him that she was a lady, that she was married, that she was in Yalta for the first time and alone, and that she was dull there. The stories told of the immorality in such places as Yalta are to a great extent untrue. He despised them, and he knew that such stories were for the most part made up by persons who who would themselves have been glad to sin if they had been able. But when the lady sat down at the next table, 3 paces from him, he remembered these tales of easy conquests, of trips to the mountains, and the tempting thought of a swift, fleeting love affair, a romance with an unknown woman whose name he did not know suddenly took possession of him. He beckoned coaxingly to the Pomeranian, and when the dog came up to him, he shook his finger at it. The Pomeranian growled. Gurov shook his finger at it again. The lady looked at him and at once dropped her eyes. "He doesn't bite," she said, and blushed.
"May I give him a bone?"
he asked. And when she nodded, he asked courteously,
"Have you been long in Yalta?"
5 days.
"And I have already dragged out a fortnight here."
There was a brief silence. "Time goes fast, and yet it is so dull here," she said, not looking.
"That's only the fashion to say it is dull here. A provincial will live in Belyov and Ojidra, not be dull, and when it comes here, it's, oh, the dullness, oh, the dust. One would think he came from Grenada."
She laughed. Then they both continued eating in silence, like strangers. But after dinner, they walked side by side, and there sprang up between them the light, jesting conversation of people who are free and satisfied, to whom it does not matter where they go or what they talk about. They walked and talked of the strange light on the sea. The water was of a soft, warm lilac hue, and there was a golden streak from the moon upon it. They talked of how sultry it was after a hot day. Gurov told her that he came from Moscow, that he had taken his degree in arts, but had a post in a bank, that he had trained as an opera singer, but had given it up, that he owned 2 houses in Moscow, and from her he learnt that she had grown up in Petersburg, but had lived in S since her marriage 2 years before, that she was staying another month in Yalta, and that her husband, who needed a holiday too, might perhaps come and fetch her. She was not sure whether her husband had a post in the Crown Department or under the Provincial Council, and was amused by her own ignorance. And Gurov learned, too, that she was called Anna Sergeyevna. Afterwards, he thought about her in his room.